Well, I'd like to give my congratulations to Dr. Walsh, and it's just such a thrill to be on the podium with two such profoundly influential contributors to the field of reproductive biology. And in my context, I want to talk a bit about developmental reproductive biology, mainly as it's impacted our clinical care of children with disorders of sexual differentiation, and then also give you some glimpse into the future, how I think some of the products that are so important in normal sexual differentiation might influence the way we take care of patients with ovarian cancer. So I bring you greetings from the Massachusetts General Hospital, which has immersed intertwined its history with the American Academy of Arts and Sciences over the years, and you can see it in its early proximity to the Harvard Medical School. But when one considers sexual differentiation, it's an amazing cascade of events, and it's incredible to me how it comes out right so often. But one must have, for proper sexual differentiation, you must have the right chromosomal endowment, as David was discussing, and then the gonads under the influence of this chromosomal endowment are differentiated properly, and then those gonads must make the right hormones, and then the tissues must respond appropriately to those hormones in order to have the ideal male and the ideal female. Sex differentiation occurs about midway through mammalian development, differentiation occurs after the primitive streak forms and before gastrulation or the turning of the embryo, and is driven by the intermediate mesoderm, which is between the ectoderm and the endoderm in the flattened embryo before the embryo undergoes closure and further differentiation. And at that time, lots of transcription factors occur, which allow us to further differentiate this intermediate mesoderm into what we call the urogenital ridge. And this urogenital ridge is posteriorly placed in the embryo, and sexually indifferent at this time, with a gonad that is has failed to declare itself as a testis or an ovary, and reproductive tracts that are representative of both the male and the female, and then also in the vicinity is the normal kidney before it ascends, and the adrenal. And this urogenital ridge then is exposed to this extraordinary master switch called SRY, the gene that's for the sex differentiation, sex-determining region of the Y chromosome. And it's a very tiny gene, and the only function that has been ascribed to it is to bend DNA. So one wonders how such an extraordinarily potent master switch can be such a simple molecule. But it's a transcription factor, and it is responsible for the differentiation of the somatic components of the gonad. And at the same time, germ cells, which perpetuate pluripotency and propagate the germ pool, are beginning a very extensive migration. There are a small number of cells within this little embryoid body that differentiate to become the germ cells. And these germ cells then undergo a really extensive migration from what's called the epiblast, which is above the embryo, all along the primitive streak, along the hindgut, where they hitch a ride, and then eventually pop into the urogenital ridge, where the germ cells then populate what is the differentiating gonad at that time. And one of David's other great contributions was the discovery of this meiosis inhibiting factor, which explains one of the long-held mysteries of the difference between the male and female gonad, and that the female germ cells go into meiosis just before birth, and the male produces this meiosis inhibiting factor and goes into arrest and then doesn't undergo meiosis until puberty many, many years later. So when the gonad differentiates as a testis under the influence of SRY, it produces two different products. One is testosterone, and the testosterone is then further modified by 5-alpha reductase, one of the genes that Patrick Walsh discovered. And this reduced form of testosterone then acts upon the external genitalia, and the external genitalia then differentiate as a male under the influence of dihydrotestosterone, and this little genital tubercle becomes a phallus, and the genital folds become the scrotal organs housing the descended gonad. And if the testosterone is deficient, then one doesn't completely undergo this differentiation. Also, one has syndromes where the adrenal produces too much testosterone, and that excess of testosterone in an XX female will influence the development of the external genitalia so that the female XX looks like a male. And these are children that we actually see and take care of with disorders of sexual differentiation. The other protein made by differentiated testis is malarian inhibiting substance, and I've had sort of a lifetime love affair with malarian inhibiting substance, and I'll tell you a little bit about that very potent hormone, which is responsible in the male for complete regression of the malarian duct that would otherwise go on to form the reproductive ducts of the female. So the male rids itself of this malarian duct under the influence of malarian inhibiting substance. So this is a child born with ambiguous genitalia. It's a 46XX patient who has had too much testosterone, therefore stimulated to form a phallus instead of a clitoris, and to form scrotal folds rather than labia. And we undertake surgery at early stage of development of these patients, and we bring the vagina down to the perineum. We reduce the clitoris and reduce the labia minora so that at the time of surgery, one has a small female clitoris labia folds, and then the external genitalia. So this is sort of bench to bedside in the care of these infants with intersex abnormalities with excess testosterone. The other protein made is this malarian inhibiting substance, and the malarian duct would otherwise go on to form the uterus, the fallopian tube, and the vagina, the upper vagina, or the cervix. And under the influence of malarian inhibiting substance, this duct that would normally completely form, here it's stained with WNT7A, undergoes complete regression under the influence of malarian inhibiting substance. Well, our love affair with MIS was started because we thought if this protein causes complete regression of the malarian duct, would it be a potential therapeutic for tumors of malarian duct origin, i.e. Cancers of the of the uterus, of the fallopian tube, and of the cervix. And Bob Scully was a great pathologist in our institution and said, look also at ovarian cancer, because ovarian cancers recapitulate the malarian duct of the embryo. So over the course of the last couple of decades, we've purified MIS, we've cloned the gene for malarian inhibiting substance, we've scaled up its production, we cloned its receptors, along with many other labs studying this, and it's studied its signal transduction pathway, defined its clinical use in ovarian, breast, prostate, cervical, and endometrial cancers, and began scale up production of this material so that we could develop it for potential clinical trials against ovarian cancer. And more recently, we've been studying the fact that ovarian cancers may be a stem cell disease, and could we isolate those stem cells and determine whether those stem cells were responsive to malarian inhibiting substance. And here we see we can inhibit ovarian cancers in a dish, we can inhibit them in animals, and can treat these animals for long periods of time with a human recombinant malarian inhibiting substance. Then we asked whether ovarian cancers are a stem cell disease, and I think this is extraordinarily important because you can be 100% successful in removing ovarian cancers surgically and then treating these patients with chemotherapeutic agents, wipe out all the disease, but in 70% of the patients, the tumors come back and are lethal within 1 or 2 years. So we looked for markers that would allow us to define this stem cell population and screened 130 markers, but selected those that would be compatible with flow cytometry so we could do gentle selection of these tumor cells and then study them for their ability to form colonies, migrate, or grow in vitro by limiting dilution. And here you see that if you isolate these stem cell populations, they grow colonies in a plate. And if we inject them into mice by limiting dilution, we get early tumor formation, indicating that we had selected a stem cell population from these tumors. And these stem cell populations responded to malarian inhibiting substance as we expected, and to small molecule mimetics that we discovered in the lab. But to our surprise, when you treated this select population with the chemotherapeutic agents that we currently use to treat ovarian cancer, we stimulated that population. Here you see a 20-fold growth of those select tumor cells with doxorubicin and about a 4 or 5-fold growth with cisplatinum. And this could be a ratio change because you kill off so many of the other cells with the chemotherapeutic agents, but we found that we could see this, observe the same phenomenon in absolute numbers by using colony formation assays. So the finding is, the important finding that was just came out in PNAS this month, was that ovarian cancers are heterogeneous from the get-go. They don't become resistant to chemotherapeutic agents, and that we really now, in our therapeutic strategy and the care of these patients, will need to separate out the stem cell population from the bulk of the tumor and treat the two different populations differently. How did I get rid of that before? There we go. And this is going to be a paradigm shift in the care of and the future of patients with ovarian cancer. And we think that our tumors are dual population, the bulk of the tumor, which responds very well to standard chemotherapeutic agents, but also the stem cell population that completely evades and is actually stimulated by our chemotherapeutic agents. So we hope in the future that both of these populations will be treated effectively treatments selected in a patient-specific manner. So we've scaled up production of malarian inhibiting substance, and we hope we'll be able to do this commercial level so that we'll be able to use this material in the treatment of patients. So we formed a company called Malaris Therapeutics Incorporated, and I hope we'll be able to continue the scale-up that we were successful with a couple of years ago with Ipsen Corporation. So what we conceive in the future for the therapy for ovarian cancer is that we will continue to do the standard of care with cryoreductive surgery and with our treatment with cisplatinum and Taxol, but now we just let these women go home and they come back for follow-up, et cetera. But it's only when they have recurrence of tumor that they are subsequently treated. And so what we're saying is that in this interval, we should be treating the stem cell population so that recurrence of the tumor is averted. I'd like to thank my colleagues. None of this work is ever done in isolation. Two of our fellows are here today, Dr. Papin and Dr. Benedict, who've worked very long and hard on this work. So it's just, I just wanted to show an example of how reproductive biology has impacted the care of children that are born with intersex abnormalities or disorders of sexual differentiation. And we have new methods of treating these patients and of operating on these patients. And also to point out that some of the discoveries made in developmental biology can have impact on those of us in this audience that face the possibility of reproductive cancers, such as ovarian cancer. So thank you very much. It's such an honor to be here tonight.